Finish up the risk factors for prostate cancer. Selenium, if you ingest a lot of selenium, you tend to decrease the risk of getting prostate cancer, especially if you take it with vitamin D, you will decrease the risk of prostate cancer. Insulin-like growth factor, which is produced in the liver. Okay, if you produce a lot of that, you will actually see an increase in the risk of prostate cancer. But the substance that is the most essential when you're talking about prostate cancer is, of course, the testosterone. The more testosterone you produce, the greater your risk of prostate cancer. Because testosterone will be converted to dihydrotestosterone, DHT, by the enzyme 5-alpha reductase. And that dihydrotestosterone will bind to the androgen receptor, and then that will lead to an increase in the growth of prostate cells. Okay, so that can lead, of course, to prostate cancer, but it also leads to BPH, the benign prostatic hyperplasia. And of course, that's why we say that the use of 5-alpha reductase inhibitors can prevent prostate cancer, in about 25% of the population. But it is very useful in the management of BPH. Not so with prostate cancer, we don't use them to treat, but you can use them to prevent the occurrence of prostate cancer. Okay, so those are the risks for prostate cancer. Some can decrease and some can increase your prostate cancer. And the reason testosterone is essential is because testosterone is more of a promoter of your prostate cancer, the same way estrogen is a promoter for breast cancer. And that's why sometimes when you treat prostate cancer, you talk about hormonal management or hormonal manipulation. And you can manipulate that hormone, that is the testosterone, either by knocking out the source of the testosterone, in which case you will be talking about archaeectomy. You remove the testes, and so you have less of your testosterone, or you can use your anti-androgens. Anti-androgens, both steroidal and non-steroidal anti-androgens, to reduce the effect of your testosterone. Or you can use your gonadotropin-releasing hormone analogs, or gonadotropin-releasing hormone antagonists. So all of those will help to manipulate the level of hormones, and then you can thereby manage your prostate cancer. So how does the prostate cancer spread? It can spread by a local movement into tissues that are surrounding the prostate. So it can spread contiguously to your seminal vesicles or to the bladder. And at that point, it can reach the urethra and the neck of the bladder, and it can impinge upon that bladder. You can put a lot of pressure so that it will look like the bladder neck is actually choking. And so the flow of urine through the urethra will also decrease because of the obstruction of the flow, or obstruction to the flow of urine through the urethra or through the bladder neck. So you have contiguous spread, which means local spread to the area, or it can spread through the lymph. So you can have lymphatic spread, which can get into the nodes, and you know once you get into the nodes, your stage of the prostate cancer will change, will get worse. Or it can spread through the blood, in which case we'll be talking about metastasis. And the part that is spread to the most is the bones. That's your number one target of the prostate cancer when it spreads or when it metastasizes. And it can affect the pelvic, the femur, just the lower portion of the body. And so that can impinge upon the spinal cord, and then you can get your paralysis of the lower limbs. You can also get the loss of function of the bladder, or loss of function of the rectum. Okay. So you can see all of those things. You can get into the liver, in which case the patient would exhibit what we know are the symptoms or characteristics of liver damage. You know, things like jaundice, right upper quadrant pain, dark urine, pruritus, things like that. Sometimes it spreads to the lungs, but the top two are liver and bones, particularly the bones. That's why during diagnosis, you always do a bone scan to check if the cancer has metastasized, and you always do a liver function test to again check if it has metastasized to the liver. So, how do you diagnose the prostate cancer? So there are different means of diagnosis. One is to measure the PSA, the prostate specific antigen, or one can measure the serum alkaline phosphatase, SAP, or you can use an ultrasound to again check for the size and hardness of the prostate. That's transrectal ultrasound. Or one can do, like we said, a bone scan, as well as your liver function test. Sometimes you can also see a chest radiography being used to diagnose the prostate cancer. And of course, one can use biopsy, and then you can do a DRE, digital rectal examination. Digital rectal examination is when the physician will use their finger to go through the rectum and feel for the size of the prostate and see if it's sort of hard, you know, and they will be able to feel growth, that is, if it has become enlarged. So that's digital rectal examination. And we always say that that's the only time you should allow anybody to give you the finger. Biopsy, of course, you just take a sample of the tissue and send it to the lab, and it will test for growth indices. Bone scan, that will tell you whether the cancer has metastasized or not. And if the bone scan suggests or records the presence of the PC, then that will tell you that you have a stage 3 or stage 4, usually stage 4 prostate cancer. And the liver function test can also support that or not. So positive bone scan means poor prognosis, because it means it has reached a high level. And then the ultrasound, transrectal ultrasound, that just again shows the size of that prostate using ultrasound. And serum alkaline phosphatase, that can also suggest the metastasis of the prostate cancer. Okay, because if your SAP is 130 to 190 international units per liter, okay, that basically means that it has gone bad or it's worse, because your normal PSA, I mean SAP, you want it to be below 130, below 125, you know. But in prostate cancer patients, that can be the range, 130 to 190. And again, high SAP suggests that the liver and the bones have been affected. And then PSA, the prostate-specific antigen, that's not usually very helpful. It's not usually conclusive. The reason is because your PSA can also go up when you just have BPH, you know, without cancer. If you have a benign prostatic hyperplasia, your PSA can also go up. If you have an infection of the urinary tract system, your PSA can go up. So it's not really that conclusive. It's better to look at the trend of the PSA as opposed to just taking a particular measure or value of the PSA. Usually we say that 0 to 4 nanograms per mil is normal. Okay. But that is also age related. 0 to 4 will be normal for people that are, you know, up to about 40, 50 years old. For somebody who is between 70 and 80, their normal PSA is actually 4.5 to 6.5 nanograms per mil. So it's age related. So that's one thing. But normally we say 0.4, that is 0 to 4 nanograms. And if it's between 4 and 10, that usually suggests BPH. And if it's above 10, then it could be suggestive of prostate cancer. But like I said, there are other conditions in which your PSA can go up. So it's good for preliminary diagnosis, but it is not very conclusive. And so those are the means that you can use to diagnose your prostate cancer. The signs and symptoms, you can divide them into what we call obstructive signs and symptoms of prostate cancer versus the metastatic signs and symptoms of prostate cancer. The obstructive would include things like difficulty in initiation of a stream, that is urination. So you will find it difficult to even start the process of urinating. And of course, the volume that is produced would also be low. So low urine production in terms of volume. Sometimes it's scanty, it's very small. And then they can have some dribbling. So it just comes out in dribbles. And you can see some bifurcation of the urine. So it comes out like a two-tier string in your obstructive signs and symptoms. And then they will feel that their excretion is incomplete, like there's still some urine left. So incomplete evacuation is what they feel. And then they can have fun. And really, they don't have fun. Because you're talking about increased frequency of urination. You're talking about urgency of urination. And then nocturnal urination. So they get up many times at night to go and urinate. Yeah. So all of those can suggest your obstructive symptoms of PC. Now, if you look at the metastatic type, the weight loss will be one of them. Impotence is one of them. And even if they have an erection, it would not be full and firm. Not have a full or firm erection, even if they have an erection. And then anemia is usually present. Hematuria, and that is what usually drives men to the clinic or to the hospital. Anytime they see blood anywhere, that's where we go. And the lower extremities, they will be weakened. Okay, so they will have weakened lower extremities. And the one that we mentioned before, the loss of the bladder function, the loss of rectal function, all of those will be present. symptoms of your PC. And then, of course, the paralysis, mostly of the lower extremities. So, those are the major signs and symptoms of your prostate cancer. And in terms of treatment, and of course we have radiation used, and then you have surgery and used, and then you have medications. In terms of radiation, well, there are certain isotopes that can be used exogenously. Okay, that is outside of the body. For instance, I-125 can be directed exogenously at the PC, at the prostate cancer. And you have the palladium isotopes that can also be used. Palladium 103. But you can also use radioisotopes systemically, especially when the prostate cancer has metastasized to the bones. So you can use bone-seeking radioisotopes. One of them is samarium. Samarium 153 can be used. Thank you. Samarium 153 can be used as a radioisotope that will target bones and go to the bones and destroy some of those prostate cancer cells. And your strontium can also be used, strontium 89. That's another radioisotope that can be used systemically. It's a bone-seeking radioisotope. So it can go and destroy the cancer cells. Now, for surgery, one can use what is called TURP. Okay. That's transurethral resection of the prostate. So it's a surgical procedure. Or, as we've mentioned before, you can use archiectomy. Or you can freeze the cancer, as we said, anytime you see cryo, it means freezing. So cryo surgery can be performed on that prostate cancer, particularly when it has not really metastasized to the bones, liver, or lungs. Okay. So if it's still in the general area, you just freeze it and then ablate it. So it's called cryoablation or cryosurgery. That can also be used. So we have different forms of surgery that can be used to reset the cancer, but the TURP is the one that is very often used. Earlier on, you can manage it with hormonal manipulation by simply removing the source of the testosterone, that is the testes. And this is where we want to go, then drugs. So again, addressing the hormones, you can hear of what we call CAB, which is combined androgen blockade. Combined androgen blockade. So you can use an anti-androgen, be it steroidal or non-steroidal in nature, and you can combine that with a gonadotropin-releasing hormone or a gonadotropin-releasing hormone antagonist. So that's what's called CAB, combined androgen blockade. So we look at some specific agents. For instance, the PARP inhibitors. We've discussed those under your breast cancer using olaparib as the representative agent. Rocaparib is also commonly used for prostate cancer. And what stands out with respect to Rubraca is the impact that it can produce. Okay. Palmar, the palms, plantar, the foot, the feet, erythrodysesthesia. Palmar, plantar, erythrodysesthesia. We, of course, mentioned that when we were discussing the side effects of capecitabine, one of the 5-FU derivatives. So go back and see that. Other than that, the pharmacology of Rubraca or Rucaparib would be basically the same as that of olaparib. Okay, so one can use your parib inhibitors, so we can leave that out. Sometimes you see this isotope or radioisotope, yttrium, especially yttrium 90. Being used in prostate cancer, it will be combined with a monoclonal antibody. Okay. And the product that contains your yttrium and monoclonal antibody is uncovered. Okay. So the monoclonal antibody can actually direct or lead the radioisotope to the prostate cancer cells, and then you get radiation of the prostate cancer, or destructive radiation. Okay, so that's the principle or the mechanism behind Oncorag, which can be used. You can have a high dose of estrogen, okay, which can be combined with your nitrogen mustard. Okay. And that is what you have in estramustin. Okay, you can see it as MCT, that's a brand name. And that's what you have in that number 4. So high dose of estrogen combined with your nitrogen mustard, one of your alkylating agents. And that works very well in prostate cancer, and you see the combinations that can be used a little better. The taxanes we know. So, your docetaxel and cabazitaxel, those are the two that are mainly used. So, toxins, when you're talking about prostate cancer, you say that cabazitaxel used a lot. And whenever you use a taxane for prostate cancer management, it is necessary to combine it with prednisone. Know the actions of your taxes, we'll discuss those. Okay. And we know about mitoxantrone also, that's your lobantron. And mitoxantrone, when it's used in prostate cancer, is also usually combined with prednisone. So that's another agent that you have to give with prednisone when you are using it to manage breast cancer and prostate cancer. And we know that your mitoxantrone can work by alkylation, an alkylating agent. The azoles, there's only one that is usually used, ketoconazole, at a very high dosage, about 800 milligrams TID. And that would inhibit, the synthesis or the production of your testosterone. So, when it's used at all, that's the dosage that's given. And of course, we've discussed the azole antifungal agents on the fungus. The 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, again, just mainly for prevention, because if you use them in prostate cancer, sometimes they can even increase that malignancy that's making worse, you know. So of course you were talking about your testosterone. As an example, your salt palmetto and your finasteride. There is a product called Jalin, which is a combination of tamsulosin and testosterone. Because usually when you use one of these 5-alpha reductase, it's still used in combination with tamsulosin. But that's in BPH. So the tamsulosin, being an alpha blocker, will relax the smooth muscles of your urethra, and that will allow urine to flow out better. And the testosterone will tend to shrink or reduce the growth of the prostate cells by inhibiting the conversion of testosterone to your dihydrotestosterone. So when you use that combination, you can increase flow and you can reduce size of the prostate cells. So, is the proliferation. Ipilimumab, it's of course a monoclonal antibody, as you see there, that will work by inhibiting CTLA-4. Cytotoxic T lymphocyte associated antigen 4. Okay, cytotoxic T lymphocyte associated antigen 4. Your CTLA-4 is another so-called off-switch protein. Okay. In other words, it can reduce your immune response, particularly the T cell response, just like we talked about under your programmed death proteins, PD-1 proteins. So if you're talking about, if you're thinking about off-switch proteins, you now have two. Your PD, programmed death one, and then the CTLA-4. So ipilimumab works by inhibiting that CTLA-4, and so the immune system can then recognize the cancer cells. So you have a lot of T cells being directed at the cancer cells. And that's a very useful drug, that ipilimumab. You can see it as Yervoy, and it is usually combined with Opdivo for the management of many types of cancer. That combination can be used for malignant melanoma, so good for skin cancer. Can also be used for the management of lung cancer, particularly NSCLC, okay. Non-small cell lung cancer, and can also be effective in the management of liver cancer, cancer of the liver. You can use the combination of Opdivo and Yervoy. And you say when you use those two, you are actually knocking out the two off-switch proteins. Because Opdivo would affect PD-1 and Yervoy would affect CTLA-4. So you're actually knocking out the two off-switch proteins. So very useful compound in terms of preventing or allowing the immune system to arise. Let me just mention this relatively new agent. Tremelimumab is like ipilimumab. So it's an agent that also inhibits CTLA-4. Okay, that's how it works. This particular drug is also sometimes combined with Imfinzi. And Imfinzi is one of your PD-1 PD-1 with a ligand, so PD-L1 inhibitors. Judo. Okay. You combine Imfinzi with Judo, you can get very good effect against your liver cancer. Very effective there. That combination can also be used to treat NSCLC, can also be used to treat extensive stage, that's what it's called. Extensive stage small cell lung cancer. So So that combination can be used for non-small cell lung cancer, can also be used for ES-SCLC, can be used for bladder cancer, can be used for gallbladder cancer. Also be used for malignant melanoma, can be used for UHCC, the uvea is unresectable hepatocellular cancer, that is liver cancer. Unresectable, meaning you cannot control it with surgery. Okay. Unresectable hepatocellular cancer. That this was the original indication of Juno, but we know that it is effective in all these other conditions. And I said it inhibits CTLA-4. Sibelucel T, when you have an infection, when a bacterium or virus or whatever enters the body, there are some cells that will recognize that as an antigen, an invading antigen. And so your APCs will be directed at that antigen, the antigen presenting cells. Okay. So the antigen presenting cells will pick up that antigen and take it to your lymph nodes. Depending on what the organism is or what form of your immune system is needed, you know, to react to that. You know, so because you have three different areas in your lymph node. You have the cortical section, you have the paracortical section, and you have the germinal section of your lymph nodes. So if you need, for instance, to activate your B cells, you will go to the germinal, for instance, or if you need to activate your CT cells, you can go to the cortical, etc. So it depends on what aspect of your immune system needs to be activated. That's what will determine where your APC would go. Okay, so you have the APC, which is the antigen presenting cells, and sometimes you can actually extract the particular antigen that is produced by a cancer cell. In the case of prostate cancer cell, it is the PAP, okay. Prostatic acidic phosphatase. That is the antigen that your prostate cancer elaborates or presents with. So if you have a prostate cancer patient, you can extract that PAP, okay, and incubate it with, say, a GM, colony stimulating factor. So that colony stimulating factor would increase the growth or the multiplication of your antigens, that is the PAP, and also your APC. Your APC can digest this antigen, okay, and then take that antigen, which is what is produced by your prostate cancer cell, take it to the lymph nodes so that you can get an increase in activity of your T cells. So that way your T cells can know exactly where to go, basically because it recognizes this whole unit, your APC, your PAP, and your GM-CSF. That combination right there, the antigen presenting cells, then the antigen itself, which is your prostatic acid phosphatase, which has grown because of the colony stimulating factor. That whole unit is what you have in this drug, sipuleucel T. And you can see it as Provenge. So basically, Provenge is an ACI, that is an autologous cellular immunotherapy. So Provenge is an ACI. Provenge is not to be confused with Nuvenge. Nuvenge is a potential vaccine for breast cancer, and it actually uses the same system as your Provenge. In other words, you have the antigen presenting cells, you have the antigen. In the case of Nuvenge, it is actually HER2. HER2-new. That's the antigen. So you have APC, you have HER2-new, and you have the colony stimulating factor. That whole complex is what you have in Nuvenge, which is now being tried as a vaccine for breast cancer. Okay. But anyway, Provenge is an ACI, you know that, and Provenge will increase the activity or the cytotoxicity of your T cells. So it will increase the cytotoxicity of your T cells. It would also increase the activation of your APC, your antigen-presenting cells. It would also increase the trafficking of your T cells to the prostate cancer cells. So it increases the movement of T cells to the prostate cancer cell. And it also induces what you call an anamnestic response. What that means is this. The first time you encounter an antigen, when you have an infection, okay, your immune system rises, destroys that organism, and then it can retain a memory of that antigen. So that the next time the antigen comes, you will have a fast response of the immune system to that antigen, such that you may not even experience that infection. That is what is called an anamnestic response. Okay, so it comes the first time, the immune system responds to it, the immune system then keeps a memory of that antigen. So that's on second exposure, you actually have the antigen being destroyed before the individual even knows that they were infected through that organism. So your Proventil does the same thing. It actually increases memory, so it induces an amnestic response. And we know that it is effective in managing metastatic, castrate-resistant prostate cancer. See, when you use TAB, you know, combined antigen blocker, you are essentially castrating the patient. You know, like you use CAB or you use archaeotomy, you are removing the source of testosterone. So it's like castration. Yeah. And sometimes the prostate cancer is resistant to that castration, and then it can metastasize. So metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer can be effectively treated with Provet. And also, we know that Provet can also be used in treating your androgen-independent prostate cancer. We mentioned that the androgen, that is testosterone, is a fuel or the promoter of prostate cancer. But it gets to a point that the prostate cancer no longer needs that fuel, that promoter. That's when you say it is androgen-independent prostate cancer. And a drug that works very well against even AIPC is your Provet. Okay. I guess we can stop there. Maybe we would simply look at these androgens when we meet online. But these are some combinations that you can see used for prostate cancer, and those are present. They're listed in your handout. You have glutamide, for instance, plus leuprolide, that's the FL. Then glutamide plus Zoladex. You know, all these are your CABs, if you will, combined androgen blockers. BL, bicalutamide plus leuprolide. And BG is bicalutamide plus gosiralin. And then PE is paclitaxel plus estramus or NMIS, estramustin. VE is vinblastine and estramustin. And then you can take prednisone like a backbone drug that you add docetaxel, that's docetaxel with prednisone, or your cabazitaxel with prednisone, mitoxantrone with prednisone, or your Zytiga with prednisone.
Okay. One question, sir. The PAPAN, with respect to Proven, is the PAPAN.
With respect to which one?
To Proven. Is the PAP antigen personalized to the patient, or is it a generic preparation? Do you have to extract it from that patient?
Yes, from that particular patient.
Okay,
yes.
Then you prepare the
right. Okay. That's why we say it's autologous. Yeah, that means from the patient.
So you can't use like a generic preparation?
No. Okay. You have to get it out of the patient, the particular patient. Okay. Any other questions?